Chapter 3. Dream Sequence 2 Alpha Agbunk Azulu, Seoul, South Korea, Episode 1, October 28, 2021, Level 3 of Bunk Azulu served as an infirmary for the wounded, military personnel and civilians alike. The bulk of the illnesses were primarily the result of radioactive toxins and radiation burns. There wasn't enough of anything, especially drinking water. Medical supplies were as scarce as breathable air outside the bunker. Misery and death were common, and the dream of returning home was no more than a paranoid delusion. Our rotation started. Only 30 seconds into our 12-hour shift, our 9-member squad encountered some drama. We were on the elevator going up to the ground floor when a Canadian sailor vomited. Our squad leader, Major General Stefani from Australia, and another member rushed to his aid. Major General Stefani asked, "Sailor, are you well enough to continue?" "Yes, ma'am," he said. On the ground floor, Major General Stefani led us through a series of hastily set up mazes. Other military personnel from all over the world were busily moving about. The folks occupying the ground floor were geniuses in person nuclear catastrophe, people with brilliant logical minds and high military rank, 3-star generals and hired from nations around the world making up the Seoul Task Force, from all branches of service. Nothing came into or went out of Bunker Zulu without Ground Zero's approval, regardless of size, scope, or pertinence. Ground Zero also had to approve any pre- or post-briefings on details and other assignments. We arrived at the designated area. Other teams and squads were huddled their respective teammates. Their details ranged from grave digging, to logistics and transport, to errand land patrols, to providing security for dignitaries, to kitchen work and everything in between. Each person who was well enough to walk had been mandated with the task of the defense and upkeep of Bunker Zulu for the survival of humankind. Our squad stood somewhere in the middle of the hangar, about 50 meters from the stage. We were surrounded by others. We were exhausted and sick and tired of everything, showing a lack of interest, a lack of motivation, and hopelessness. A male Japanese fighter pilot named Ita seemed to enjoy peeling off his severely burned skin, injuries he'd sustained from thermal radiation. Among the squad, his burns seemed worse than most. Blood covered over the spots he scratched, which made him groan. I grabbed his hand and told him to stop. Don't scratch all your skin away in one day. Save some for tomorrow. Blood dripped down to the floor. He complained, "Damn briefings. As if we don't have enough to worry about." A half-bald woman said, "I hope not to get another shitty detail." She was from South Korea Defense Force, a naval linguist. Like most locals who resided in Seoul, she had lost contact with her family members, neighbors, and friends. Squad leaders were summoned to meet with the detail distributor, usually a 3-star general or dignitary or a high-ranking politician. Up there on stage, each squad leader chose a small folded piece of paper containing information about the detail. The detail distributor noted which squad had picked what detail, then charged each squad leader to carry out the mission without fail. Major General Stefani handed a piece of paper to her deputy, a lieutenant colonel from the Vietnamese army, a petite man 5 feet in height with gray hair. He took the note, read it, and frowned. He showed it to us, debt collectors. This detail required additional gear, what we called a death tuxedo, which consisted of black rubber gloves, boots, a mask, and the suit itself. The death tuxedo was bulky, heavy, and extremely uncomfortable, very difficult to put on and take off. After having been assigned to collect the dead several times in the past, we had gotten smarter and had come to the realization that if the odor of decomposing bodies didn't kill us, then wearing the death tuxedo would from the lack of breathable oxygen. It was extremely hard to breathe and work in. We opted not to sign for our death tuxedo suits. General Stroh from Germany, commanding general for tactical equipment assurance, lectured us about safety protocols. He yelled at us with his head stuck out the small window of his office that also SCRVED is an issuing point for death tuxedos and other highly sensitive equipment. The bags under his eyes and his messy hair, cigar breath, and wrinkled military uniform told the tale that he was overtired and weary. "Welcome to the club, General Stroh." After some 10 minutes, he retracted his head, slammed the small window shut, and disappeared into his office. That was one of our 3 stops prior to being officially charged with the detail. We were in the back of the compound, somewhere within the maze on the ground floor. We made our way toward the left side, going through a series of mazes of offices and stopping somewhere along the left wall. Major General Stefani had been gifted with an amazing memory. She remembered precisely where things were located within the square mile maze. Even though it was a repeated endeavor, I continued to be profoundly confused about where things were located. Other squads had arrived ahead of us and were waiting for the next authorized personnel to release us from Bunker Zulu to perform our details. This stop was a combination medical briefing and an interfaith briefing. Dr. Santos posted new photos of the recently deceased on the wall in the front of her office. The photos included no facial shots and no IDs. Only enlarged images of the wounds were shown. One photo showed some badly decomposed cadavers with third-degree burns covering more than 80% of bodies. Other photos showed corpses scattered throughout the streets of Seoul amid the rubble from skyscrapers, the once popular city of 25 million people reduced to wreckage and ruined beyond recognition. Nothing was left standing. Only debris remained. Cadavers waited for collection. A physician held up a stack of documents, the consent forms for disposing of a body. She asked, "Who needs one?" No hands went up from among the more than 100 of us. Dr. Santos's bloodshot eyes, messy hair, and disheveled uniform reminded us that no one was exempted from the upkeep and defense of Bunker Zulu. Next, she held up Holy Bible and asked, "Any religious requests?" No hands went once that was done, it was chow time. Long lines of personnel moved at a snail's pace to pick up their rations. A small bottle of water, a BB&J sandwich, a quarter of an apple, and a quarter of an orange. The mess sergeant screamed, "This is not Sunset Cafe. Take your fist and move out." We lined up by squad, more than 25 squads readying themselves to go out into the toxic environment. The personnel at the bay door made their last checks and verifications. They'd gotten so lazy, and were so influenced by overtiredness and complacency, that they were merely going through the motions. Sometimes their stuttering speech made no sense. Their blathering idiocy infected us with lethal doses of annoyance. As if it weren't bad enough that outside, the toxic air was killing us slowly, these jackasses and morons were not made our lives any easier. In the bed of an old Toyota pickup truck, we sat with our backs hunched. We'd been assigned to gather up the cadavers in Sector 3 Alpha. Its precise location, somewhere in the southernmost region of Seoul. Everything was in ruins, and every place looked the same. Endless debris from buildings, houses, shops, highways, and construction sites, the evidence of what was once a mighty economic superpower now having become distant dream, pushing the envelope toward delusion and hallucination. It was foolish to even contemplate rebuilding Seoul. The unseasonal changes in the weather caused by the radioactive contaminant slowly drained the energy from all living beings and things, sapping their strength. It was only a matter of time before there would be another series of seemingly unending death and destruction. Even with all this in view, hardly anyone in the pickup noticed anything out of the ordinary about the Pison Nuclear Environment. Chapter 3, Dream Sequence 2, Alpha Ag Bunker Zulu, Seoul, South Korea, Episode 1, October 28, 2021, Level 3 of Bunker Zulu served as an infirmary for the wounded, military personnel and civilians alike. The bulk of the illnesses were primarily the result of radioactive toxins and radiation burns. There wasn't enough of anything, especially drinking water. Medical supplies were as scarce as breathable air outside the bunker. Misery and death were common, and the dream of returning home was no more than a paranoid delusion. Our rotation started. Only 30 seconds into our 12-hour shift, our 9-member squad encountered some drama. We were on the elevator going up to the ground floor when a Canadian sailor vomited. Our squad leader, Major General Stefani from Australia, and another member rushed to his aid. Major General Stefani asked, "Sailor, are you well enough to continue?" "Yes, ma'am," he said. On the ground floor, Major General Stefani led us through a series of hastily set up mazes. Other military personnel from all over the world were busily moving about. The folks occupying the ground floor were geniuses in Pison nuclear catastrophe, people with brilliant logical minds and high military rank, 3-star generals and hired from nations around the world making up the Seoul task force, from all branches of service. Nothing came into or went out of Bunker Zulu without GORND-0's approval regardless of size, scope, or pertinence. Ground Zero also had to approve any pre- or post-briefings on details and other assignments.